May 2022, the Chancellery in Berlin. Narendra Modi is here with some of his most senior cabinet members for a day of intense consultations with their German counterparts. The result, a long list of agreements between the two sides on green development, secure communications, migration, and many more issues. This was just the latest in a whirlwind of engagement between the West and India. Modi also made stops in France and Denmark. The US hosted talks of foreign and defense ministers in Washington. And of course, the Raisina dialogue we saw earlier with large delegations from many Western countries. Joe Biden has personally extolled the importance of US-India ties.
The relationship between India and the United States, the largest democracies in the world, is destined to be stronger, closer, and tighter, and I think it can benefit the whole world.
But it's the so-called Quad that's getting the most attention, a four-way grouping of Indo-Pacific democracies, the US and India, together with Japan and Australia.
The Quad is not a formal alliance, but it is potentially at least an extremely strong partnership because it does bring together the main Indo-Pacific democracies. India is a very, very natural partner for Australia.
The Quad came to prominence under the Trump administration, part of the sharpened US pushback against China. Lisa Curtis was key to steering this.
India is a central pillar to the US Indo-Pacific strategy in terms of India's influence throughout the region, its economic, political, growing military influence in the region. The US very much wants India to have those capabilities to assert more power and to become that net provider of security that the US has envisioned. So that's why we see the US supporting India, building defense security ties, putting emphasis on the Quad. The Quad has taken off in the last couple of years.
The four powers hold regular naval exercises, as seen in this Indian Navy video. They're designed to make their forces work together and send signals to Beijing that crucial shipping lanes must remain free. But the Quad is not a military grouping. And India's government is cautious about talk that it's all about containing China.
The Quad is not intended to be threatening to China, but the Quad is intended to message that democracies have shared interests that you cannot have with non-democracies. And so we are working together to reassure and assure some of the fundamental principles of a democratic and open world, which is access to the sea lanes, respect for sovereignty, and all of that.
But there are calls for the Quad to become something more.
But we had never allowed it to develop a security component. Well, maybe we need to rethink that, because maybe we will need such a mechanism, since the Chinese are breathing down our borders and they've just killed our soldiers less than 2 years ago. So, for example, do I see a problem with introducing a military dimension into the Quad? If the others are willing, I wouldn't have minded one. Would I want to see more than just information sharing with some of the Western countries, where there is indeed some cooperation, particularly in the counterterrorism front already, intelligence sharing and so on? Would I be willing to see more than that in terms of military cooperation? My answer is yes.
Some have even talked about the Quad as the seed of an Asian NATO, a full-scale defensive alliance. But for India, that would be a break with its tradition of resisting alliances, a tradition deeply held across the political spectrum.
Some people asked, is India's position one of strategic ambiguity? No, it is not. India is quite clear that we are not ambiguous. We will take steps primarily from national interest and in cooperation with other democracies. What the difference also means is this, that alliances in the West have had a mixed track record. In the Middle East, the US has had many, many alliances. Not all of them have fared very well.
Would I want India to publicly declare itself an ally of a country, I'm not even sure I'm ready to bite that bullet, because the word alliance implies to some degree a mortgaging of your freedom to make your own decisions. And we are a country that has been under 200 years of foreign rule, where a foreign country was making our security decisions and our geopolitical postures for us. Having won our sovereignty just 75 years ago, for us it's too precious to compromise and surrender. We want to be the ones deciding our own fate.
Despite that, Lisa Curtis told us that the US would be up for an alliance with India if attitudes in Delhi were to change.
Well, I think the answer is yes. The U.S. would be very interested in having a very close partnership, even an alliance, if it were possible. But it's frankly not possible. India is not interested in having an alliance with any country.
For now, Jay Panda says what India wants is for the West to get serious about providing the military technology it needs and to support the development of its own defense industry.
We can't afford to just have a huge gap in our defense capabilities if those equipments are not available from Russia. Now, as I said, despite buying tens of billions of dollars worth of defense equipment from the US and other Western countries, we are still denied certain critical defense technology and equipment. That has to change. And India can't just remain the biggest acquirer of defense equipment. We have to start making it on our own. There must be co-production here. India can't be just a source to sell equipment to. The Indian domestic defense industry is growing in leaps and bounds under Prime Minister Modi. The West needs to participate in that.
So Western powers have some decisions to make about how much military tech they're willing to share with India. But this push for closer ties goes well beyond security.
At the Raisina dialogue in Delhi, the European Union's most powerful figure hailed a new deal for engagement on technology and trade. And she held out the prospect of a bigger goal yet, a free trade agreement.
Therefore, I am very pleased that today Prime Minister Modi and I have agreed to establish an EU-India Trade and Technology Council to tackle key trade, economic and technological challenges. We have launched negotiations on a free trade agreement, as well as on investment protection and geographical indications. For Europe, this is a strategic investment in our partnership with India.
Ursula von der Leyen's message was well received by delegates at the Raisina dialogue.
Exports have been a very fundamental part of our, the tech-driven, services-driven growth story of the last 30 years. So exports and imports, the trade is very, very important for us, and I cannot underscore enough the relevance of a lot of these trade agreements.
But the politics of free trade agreements are difficult. The US and India are both outside the world's biggest free trade zone, RCEP, which recently came into force in Asia. That's led to fears that it will become dominated by China. So both the West and India are under pressure to keep up the pace.
Well, free trade agreements are notoriously complex to negotiate, but EU free trade agreements are even more difficult. I think what is more interesting is to see how India has changed its mind on FTAs. For the longest time, India was seen as very protectionist and very reluctant to do FTAs. And now it's in negotiating stages with Canada, with the United Kingdom, with a number of other partners, and with the EU.
We have a lot to learn from Europe and a lot to gain by strengthening this relationship. Not just again in terms of trade, but even in terms of regulations. For instance, the whole data protection laws. To a large extent, we are motivated. We are quite inspired by the changes and reforms that Europe is bringing in, because human rights are at the center of a lot of the reforms that are being brought in. And India, being a plural democracy, a liberal democracy, I think those are our aspirations as well. So moving forward, there is only one way we can really move, which is closer.
You hear a lot about values underpinning these projects. That is, democracies, India and the West, are a natural fit. The question is, how close are they really?
Delhi, 2022. Properties owned by Muslims are demolished by local authorities. DW covers events on the scene.
Bulldozer is a term trending in India right now as a troubling wave of anti-Muslim violence hits the country. Authorities gave orders for bulldozers to demolish many structures here. These businesses that stood behind me were largely owned by Muslims. And videos even show officials ripping into the outer entrance to a mosque. Officials say these demolition drives targeted illegal buildings. But many Muslims here feel there is a pattern of them being targeted. Over the weekend, a throng of Hindu men in a religious procession passed through this predominantly Muslim neighborhood. Communal riots broke out, leaving several injured. Similar clashes erupted in several states.
The Bhartiya Janata Party, or BJP, of Prime Minister Narendra Modi has been accused of whipping up hatred against Muslims as part of a Hindu nationalist agenda. This goes back two decades. In 2002, as many as 2,000 people, most of them Muslims, were killed in riots in Modi's home state of Gujarat. Modi was chief minister in the state at the time. He was accused of failing to stop the violence or even condoning it. This had consequences for his relations with the US. In 2005, American authorities refused to give him a visa on grounds of severe violations of religious freedoms. Since he became prime minister in 2014, Modi's government has pushed through a number of steps seen as mapping out an anti-Muslim agenda, particularly in his second term, beginning in 2019. In August of that year, the government stripped India's only Muslim-majority state, Kashmir, of its special semi-autonomous status under the constitution. It was placed under a draconian lockdown, with internet links cut, senior local politicians arrested, and media access severely constrained. Then in December 2019, a new Citizenship Amendment Act regulated how migrants from countries in the region could become Indian citizens. It offered a fast track to Hindus and some other religious groups, but not to Muslims. The United Nations said it was fundamentally discriminatory. Protests against the law escalated into communal riots in Delhi. More than 50 people were killed, with police accused of aiding Hindu mob attacks on Muslims. Journalist Hartosh Singh Bal is political editor of the news magazine The Caravan, which is critical of Modi's BJP. He worries about the cumulative effect of what's happening.
The slow burn of violence directed against Muslims, Muslims getting lynched in trains, in streets, attacked merely on the suspicion of maybe they are carrying beef, which is one way of identifying them as other. They eat beef, which Hindus are not supposed to. The constant hate that is fed through Facebook, WhatsApp, Twitter, that is part of this project. Clearly, in terms of public life, Muslims have never had it so bad as they have it today, and it is growing worse with each passing day.
Hartosh Singh Bal says Muslims are fading away from India's political stage.
Muslim representation in the legislatures across the country, not just in parliament, but in state legislatures which govern the federal units of the Indian state, has fallen dramatically. It is probably at its lowest since 1947 today. So you don't have that presence in political power, and this is a minority that is 15% of the Indian population, 200 million people. It is larger than almost every country in Europe, just this minority.
Jay Panda is one of the most prominent figures in the BJP. He denies the party has an anti-Muslim agenda.
One of the arguments being made against BJP is that it is majoritarian. It is against the minorities. That's not the case. We have traditionally not received very many minority votes, but that is increasing every time. In the recent elections in UP, our vote share for Muslims grew by 2%. It's nearly double digits now. In Assam, we recently had urban elections in 80 towns, 80 municipalities. A dozen of them have dominant minority votes, which the BJP won, all of them. Now, these are facts that are often not presented to Western viewers. Because of certain vested interests. I urge your viewers and Western visitors to go deeper into the matter and understand this.
The 2022 election in UP, or Uttar Pradesh, that Jay Panda mentioned, saw the BJP further strengthen its power in India's most heavily populated state. Re-elected as chief minister was Yogi Adityanath, a Hindu monk who's seen as an anti-Muslim radical and a possible future leader of the BJP. The Uttar Pradesh election was the latest disaster for India's main opposition party, the Congress. Leading the campaign was Priyanka Gandhi, from the political dynasty that's dominated the party since Indian independence. Here, it won just over 2% of the vote. Prominent Congress figure Shashi Tharoor admits that the party is on the brink. There are calls for it to make a break from the Gandhi family.
Well, I think that there is a widespread perception that the party needs change and overhaul. About the question of a particular set of leaders, the answer is that, you know, that will depend on what the party workers want. There is no question that the Congress has been suffering defeat after defeat in a number of situations for some time, and that some of us have rather openly within the party called for very specific steps to revive it. Many of us feel that this is really a last chance to get our act together with just 2 years to go for the next general elections.
Some regional parties are significant players, such as the ARP, led by Delhi Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal. But none comes anywhere near to challenging the BJP on a national level. Modi is supreme.
The BJP's critics say that its power is not just political, that it's backed up by massive business interests, a fusion of financial power and media influence.
TV is a major source of news for hundreds of millions of Indians, and it's dominated by a small number of giant conglomerates that are friendly to the government.
People are in the media not for the money they can make from the media, but basically for the influence peddling with the government that they can do. So you combine this model of large financial ownership. Such large financial ownership almost always in India has business interests spread across the economy. Most of those business interests are far larger than the media interest. In some ways, the media is then seen as a trade-off of influence to help your other businesses grow. That is what is driving media in India today. So these large owners, many of them the equivalent of what you would call oligarchs in the case of Russia, own media. They have close links to the government.
Some non-corporate media outlets do survive, including Hartosh Singh Bal's own Caravan magazine, which has income from subscriptions. But like others, it faces an ongoing barrage of legal threats.
All of us have, for various aspects of our reporting, faced police cases. There are sedition cases going on against our owners and my editor, Vinod Jose. This is part of the game. Other organizations have similar sedition cases, cases for reporting what the government doesn't like. We have defamation cases going on against us by the son of the National Security Advisor, Ajit Doval. So things like this are par for the course. But do they impinge our day-to-day ability to do what we need to do? At the moment, no. And I think that is primarily because the government does not see us as real threats. We are pinpricks, and it can allow us to exist in some ways, even sell us as proofs of the fact that there is an independent media environment in this country.
The outside world is taking note. In 2022, India slipped from 142nd to 150th place in the Press Freedom Index, produced by Reporters Without Borders. When the index began 20 years ago, it was ranked at number 80.
It's questions over the commitment to pluralism and equal rights in the BJP's India that are causing most concern in the West.
There is concern about the treatment of Muslim minority under the BJP government, particularly the second term, Modi's second term. We've seen some problematic developments with the Citizenship Amendment Act, which clearly discriminates against Muslims. I would just call Indian leaders back to their own, you know, founding documents and their own traditions of having, knowing that a strong democracy is represented by the protections that it provides to its minorities.
Jay Panda of the BJP insists his party is committed to exactly that.
Let me make it very clear. India's constitution is going to be the final arbiter of every Indian's fate, and India's constitution gives equal rights to every citizen. Muslim, Hindu, Christian, Sikh, Buddhist, everyone.
And Western leaders are highly cautious about speaking out in public. At the Raisina dialogue, Ursula von der Leyen was all praise for Indian democracy and made no mention of concerns of human rights. Germany's minister for the region did say concerns would be raised at the intergovernmental consultations, but he was very cautious too.
I'm not here in India to teach and preach, but if our advice is needed and is welcome, Germany is willing to help and to support.
And after the consultations in Germany finished, there was no mention of human rights from either Olaf Scholz or Narendra Modi at their joint press appearance. And unusually for such an occasion, they took no questions at all at the Indian side's insistence. Even Joe Biden is reluctant to openly criticize Modi. When they met last year, he offered only a gentle hint of his views on events in India.
And as the world celebrates Mahatma Gandhi's birthday next week, we're all reminded that his message of non-violence, respect, tolerance matters today maybe more than it ever has.
Of course, Western countries with so many failings of their own, many of them with histories of colonizing the global South, well, they have to think very carefully about criticizing a country like India.
In a discussion looking back over 75 years since Indian independence, India's external affairs minister had a clear message for the West. We won't submit to your judgment.
Look, we have to be confident about who we are. I think it's better to engage the world on the basis of who we are, rather than try and please the world as a pale imitation of what they are. This idea that others define us, that, you know, somewhere there we need to get approval of other quarters, I think that's an era we need to put behind us.
It's a message echoed by Jay Panda of Modi's BJP.
The West needs to recognize that a strong, robust India and a secure India is not only in India's interest, not only in the West's interest, but also for the world, because this is the largest democracy that humankind has ever seen. Friends don't have to always agree with each other, but friends do have to have a core shared agreement, which I think we are gradually getting there. We are certainly cooperating much more with Western countries compared to just two decades ago.
Garima Mohan of the German Marshall Fund think tank straddles the gap between India and Europe. She says Europeans wanting to nudge India in a more liberal direction are well advised to focus on civil society.
Europe has a legacy problem with India because of the experience of colonialism. I think countries have to be very mindful of what leverage they have to influence change in a third country. What can outside actors do? I think it is important to keep faith in domestic actors and what they're doing, and asking how these actors in civil society or academia, intelligentsia, how they would like to be supported, if so. So I think Europe has these conversations. Many foundations, European foundations, work in India. They work with a lot of groups in India. And I think they're having those conversations. I think that is the best way to support this.
As for India's beleaguered opposition, Shashi Tharoor rejects suggestions that Indian democracy itself is under imminent threat.
Well, as an opposition member of parliament who's allowed to function freely and who criticizes the government day in and day out in the public space, I mean, I will still say we are a democracy. Our elections are largely accepted as free and fair.
But Tharoor does say he's worried about the direction of travel.
There have been more and more indications of autocracy. There have been a hollowing out of institutions of our state, which were formerly independent and whose independence was greatly prized, which have become much more overtly or covertly subordinate to the interests of the government or the ruling party. I think what we can say is from having been a liberal democracy, we've become a much more illiberal one.
From his vantage point working in independent media, Hartosh Singh Bal has a darker view.
India is coming to resemble Russia and China far more than it resembles Western democracies. That the illusion that it is necessarily in that camp given what is happening here, is not borne out by the facts on the ground here necessarily. So the West will have to deal with this country through very hard-nosed means rather than by thinking that this common shared value of constitutional democracy is going to pull India into our sphere. That is not true. India has no such desire. This regime in India does not represent any desire to emulate the idea of constitutional democracy. It is trying to subvert.
So for all the talk of India and the West coming together around shared values to push back against autocracies, is that really what's happening here?
I think that is not the right framing for building a stronger relationship between Europe and the Indo-Pacific. Because if we go with certain standards, then a lot of countries in the Indo-Pacific will not fit to those standards of democracy and other issues that are being brought up. So I think one has to recognize the diversity of political systems that exist in the Indo-Pacific. And therefore, I personally feel that this democracy versus authoritarian framing is not very useful because it will alienate more partners than it will win.
The West would clearly like Delhi to sign up fully to the club of liberal democracies. But as we've seen, it's not a perfect fit for either side. But let's think back for a moment to where we started and India's geopolitical squeeze between a Russia going rogue and a mounting threat from China. While India faces some massive choices ahead, Western powers also have some hard thinking to do. And I get a strong sense that some honesty on their part would go down well here. When dealing with superpowers with no such qualms, there's no time to lose.